You're watching CNBC Africa's Rwanda Focus debate. Just a couple of days after the country's 2015-16 budget was read, a bigger budget by record compared to the previous one, we'd like to sit down with the minister to look at exactly what this portends for Rwanda's growth and where this is heading to. And so we are very honored this afternoon to have the Honorable Minister for Finance and Economic Planning, Claver Gatete. Karibu sana.
Sante.
Also in the audience, we have students from the University of Kigali who will be engaging and raising questions in regards to the conversations that we'll be having here today. My name is Bonney Tunya. Mr. Minister, thank you very much for making time. I know you have a very busy schedule this afternoon, but let's just jump right into it. Rwanda had just under 2 trillion budget. And obviously, when we look at the East African countries, most of the budgets have been expansionary. They've been growing, and thus they've been informed by a lot of infrastructure development. Give us a sense of this incremental growth, because we're looking at, what, about 140 billion bigger than last year's. Give us a sense of what informed this kind of growth.
Yeah, usually the growth, first of all, is dependent on so many factors. One is the growth of the GDP. You know, our GDP has been growing significantly. At around 8% since 2000, it has expanded more than almost close to three times, right, in the last, I think, 15 years. So this expansion of the economy informs the budget. Then secondly is also the planning process.
Right.
Where do you want to go in line with your vision, Vision 2020 that you have, where we need to become a middle-income country by the year 2020. That also informs that. But at the same time, you need to make sure that as you go forward, you're also careful to make sure that the macroeconomic fundamentals remain correct. As your GDP grows, your inflation should be in check, your debt ratio should be really within the limits of what would make an economy stable,
right,
in order to maintain our good rating, which is now at B plus, mm-hmm, with stable outlook.
Right.
And at the same time, knowing that actually the money is targeted in the right areas, especially those that have an impact on growth,
right,
and also on development as well. So the budget is prepared within that context. We start with the planning process. We go through the budget process.
Right.
We discuss the budget framework paper. After discussing the budget framework paper and agreed on with the comments from the parliament, mm-hmm, then we make the final budget numbers. And these budget numbers are the ones that we present in areas that are priority to the government, that we think that with that kind of investment,
right,
then it's going to sustain the growth, at the same time addressing all the other issues, economic, social, governance, and other issues,
right,
of the country.
Mr. Minister, when we look at the East African budget, and particularly Rwanda, it's very impressive to note that Rwanda intends to raise over 60% from domestic resources. And this is a trend that is still very new in East Africa. It's very, there are lots of challenges, mm-hmm, as regards to this. And when I was looking at the number, I said 62 was a bit ambitious. Give us a sense of how you intend to achieve this.
Yeah, usually it's our financing, in as much as you say domestic, we've been very careful. We started after genocide when you are getting almost 100% of the money coming from abroad.
Mm-hmm.
And these were coming in terms of grants.
Right.
The money that we use in the budget is either from our taxes, from non-tax revenues, from the domestically borrowed money, mm-hmm, from the external borrowed money,
right,
and from the donors in terms of aid. In this case, the domestic resources, 62.4% of the entire budget is from the domestic resources. The money that is borrowed, of which we are, it's almost the same thing as government-owned money, because,
right,
we borrow and we pay back.
Mm-hmm.
That is 18.9%. And 18.7% is the money that comes in the form of grants,
mm-hmm,
what you would call aid. And in this case, if you put the two together, then you find that actually the about 81.3% of the money is actually where you have full control, because it is either domestic tax revenues,
right,
or it's money that is borrowed.
Mm-hmm.
And that way that the only chunk that you call aid,
mm-hmm,
is really that 18.7%.
Right.
And the 81.3% is the money that I would call government money.
Right.
The other one is just aid. So if we can work to make sure that we can cover that gap, then you have done a great job. And you are seeing our revenues going up. And that's why we are putting measures to make sure that we can really increase the tax base, bring in as many people in the tax bracket as possible.
Right.
And that's why we are actually scaling up the use of the electronic billing machines
right. All
over the country so that people can know how much you are trading, rather than just putting you in categories and without knowing exactly how much you are making in terms of turnover.
Yeah.
But this time, everybody will have a free EBM all over the country, so that we'll start rolling them out around September.
But Mr. Minister, there's a lot of concern that every time we talk about budget, there's obviously focus on taxes and collection, because that is where the bulk of the money comes from. But give us a sense of the tax revenues to, say, GDP. How has the collection been for Rwanda in, say, the last 2 years?
Yeah, it has been now for about 15.4%, but it's going up. 15.4%, going to 16%, then going to 18%.
Right.
We have that target, and that's why we are saying is that, number one, one of the reforms, and this, by the way, excludes the local government taxes.
Right.
I'm just talking about the normal taxes that we collect, excluding the local government taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Part of the reform that we did was to make sure that one revenue authority, which has the capacity, which has the experience, which has the knowledge, can be able to collect taxes on behalf of the local government,
right,
and then get a commission, because it has the entire infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
And right now they are doing all the, putting all the data together to make sure that you have the information of what constitutes the taxes. There are three, usually, the taxes: the property tax, the rental tax, and then the normal fees. So those ones, they are now have, at least they are putting together all the information, the data, so that the taxes would go up. And even from the time they started late last year, we are seeing already the improvement. Then number two, we are saying we have many people who are coming in, especially the SMEs and the informal sector.
Right.
How do they come to the tax base?
Mm-hmm.
So that you don't raise taxes, but there is efficiency in terms of tax collection.
Yes.
And that efficiency is the one that is really helping. And that's why one of the way to do it is making sure that we can see what you are trading in a transparent manner.
Right.
So that everybody pays their own share of taxes.
Right.
And this is helpful, because you cannot do it by just having people to cooperate when actually it's very difficult to know whether what they are trading is the right one.
There's a lot of tax incentives, especially when you talk about foreign businesses.
Yeah.
But for the SMEs that you mentioned, how else do we encourage them to pay? Because people will say, yes, I'm working really hard. Maybe I'm not ready to pay now. How do we, are there incentives for local businesses to ensure that SMEs that are coming on the formal or informal sector are able to submit their taxes?
Yeah, first of all, let me just clear one thing. The incentives, whether it's for big, for medium, for small and micro, it's not, there is no demarcation between foreigners and nationals.
Right.
It's for everybody. It's for all the private sector, whether you are, because for us, we are looking at whether you are big, medium, or small.
Right.
Rather than being foreign or non-foreign, because the incentives apply
because
the same way.
Because these small local corporations, first, it's very hard to get their data. No one really knows where they are or what they trade in, like you said. But then also, most of them don't feel like they are ready to submit to the tax maybe in the first 2-3 years of business. And maybe they will need a little bit of pushing.
Yeah, first of all, their tax levels are low because they're also getting less income.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one. Then number two, what we are trying to do is to help them actually, for them to even know how to do this. And that's why the EBM helps them.
Right.
Because once you do the trading, then you know your turnover, then you know what you are supposed to pay, rather than someone coming and say, well, maybe you should be paying this or that.
Mm-hmm.
But this time you can be accurate and make sure that the incentive that you gave them is actually helping them.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, but at the same time, you are getting the accurate numbers, and then once you help them, as you have always done in terms of helping their businesses on how to do the accounting side and all that, it helps them. But the incentives are there for the SMEs. The incentives are there for the big companies and medium companies, and really there is no discrimination of any kind in terms of that.
So it cuts across the board.
It cuts across the board.
But Minister Gatete, there is also the concern of the efficiency in collection, and we've seen this not just in Rwanda but across the region, where different governments consequently miss their targets. This has been attributed to a lot of issues. But give us a sense of what Rwanda is doing to ensure that probably come 2017-18, we are close to our tax target.
Actually, we are meeting our targets even now.
Right.
Even for this financial year, the target of Revenue Authority, mm-hmm. we are going to exceed a bit.
Okay.
The target. Mm-hmm. So it's not missing the target.
Mm-hmm.
No, they are really going to exceed the target.
Right.
And the reason for that is the efficiency of how they do that. And that's why the procedures law, mm-hmm. which is helping them to make sure there are no rigidities.
Right.
We are also streamlining to make sure that usually the laws can also bind you, mm-hmm. whereby you are saying, if you don't pay this, there are heavy punishments, mm-hmm. and then it becomes very difficult for a company to pay back if there's
right.
no flexibility in the way that you really administer the taxes.
Right.
So we are removing all these kind of issues that would hinder people mm-hmm. who want to pay but they can't because of the heavy penalties. We are reducing that and we are making it more flexible. So the way we deal with the private sector, mm-hmm. the way we communicate,
right.
the way we introduce electronic means, because right now in terms of paying taxes or other things, you do it electronically. You don't need to come and line up. You don't need to go anywhere.
Right.
We are making it easier for anybody to declare, to pay taxes without meeting anyone,
right.
just electronically.
I'd like us to shift focus a little bit away from the tax issue mm-hmm. and talk a little bit about the allocations, which were obviously anchored on the economic development and poverty mm-hmm. reduction strategy for Rwanda. Give us a sense of, we've looked at some of these allocations. There's the whole issue of economic transformation. Give us a status update of how exactly that works.
Yeah, usually when we did our economic development and poverty reduction strategy, we focused on four pillars. One was economic transformation.
Right.
Because you need to grow the economy, and you are looking at key pillars of growing that kind of economy.
Mm-hmm.
The big infrastructure,
right.
the trade, the big ones, the energy. So this is the economic transformation.
Right.
The second one was rural development.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where agriculture has a big impact. The rural markets, the feeder roads, the rural electrification, mm-hmm. and so forth. This is the area of rural development. The third one was actually productivity and youth employment. And this one here, we are trying to see the youth. The number is growing significantly.
Mm-hmm.
These are some of these people who will be graduating and are looking for jobs. And they want to make sure that the education part, to make sure that the technical and vocational training, the skills, the entrepreneurship
yes.
skills really are benefiting the ordinary people so that they can really get jobs. And
right.
that's why you have the National Employment Program,
mm-hmm.
but also improves productivity. So that's another third area. And then finally, of course, we have the accountable governance area.
Mm-hmm.
Really, without governance, all these things that we are doing will not be sustainable. So the allocation this time, once we looked at all the priority areas, after discussing at the planning level, and at the budget level. Then we allocated 27% of the total amount of money
mm-hmm.
on the economic transformation. And then the 13% was on rural development. And then, of course, coming down to youth and employment, we allocated 5% and 10% for accountable governance. But then we have what they call foundational areas
right.
that support the whole economy. So the whole thematic areas, 55%, but the foundational areas, 45%.
Correct.
And this has to do with everything from justice to education to many other areas that support the whole program. So that's how we distributed it. But then within those kind of grouping areas,
right.
then we pick and say, what are the key areas really that would move the economy?
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, we focus really on three things. One of them, we said, the big target is to make sure that we grow our own industries
right.
that are producing rather than importing that can really help us
yes.
in terms of improving domestic production. Because here most of our products are raw commodities in nature. And is for the value chain, at some point, you don't get the value because you want to produce and increase production. But at the same time, you need the industries to produce some of the things that you really import if you have a comparative advantage. And at the same time, the export side,
right.
because of the balance of payments, and you've seen the increase in the drop in the prices of minerals and other commodities, and they wanted to make sure that really we focus on that in terms of the resources to help the export sector. So that area of export side or the external sector has been very, very important.
Right.
The second one was agriculture productivity.
Correct.
not just the entire agriculture, but focusing on productivity, is what do you do at the production level in terms of the inputs, in terms of seeds, in terms of fertilizers, in terms of irrigation, and in terms of post-harvest handling,
right,
the whole value chain up to the processing level. Mm-hmm. What are we doing to make sure that we can improve the entire productivity?
Right.
The third one was, how do you reduce the cost of doing business, especially focusing on infrastructure, the energy, the water, and other areas that are helping really the that are reducing the cost of doing business.
Yes.
So those are the areas that have formed the core,
right,
whether they fall in economic transformation,
yes,
or rural development or elsewhere, but that has been very, very important.
I know, looking at the economic transformation agenda for Rwanda, and there has been a lot of projects that are long-term and that have been allocated resources for. Are you happy with the level of absorption year on year, and how can we improve this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so far, definitely we've been working on this as government. Mm-hmm. It had been raised as an issue because, first of all government programs, we have a monitoring system. We have the, what you call the IFMIS, Integrated Financial Management System, that tracks all the projects from procurement up to the payment level. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, now we have included other projects,
right,
which are financed externally, so that they are in the bracket. And we've dealt with issues of poor planning that used to happen, that used to actually cause more problems for the projects. Now, for all the projects, they have to be discussed at the Public Investment Committee, approved. It has all the elements, making sure that you only approve the projects when they are ready to go. This has helped in terms of improving the performance of the projects.
Mm-hmm.
And now the results are showing, because now we have a way of making sure that we can track the projects right from the beginning.
Right.
Halfway, we do the evaluations. We produce a report to the cabinet every 3 months,
mm-hmm,
and we report back. We discuss with all the institutions that are in charge of the various projects and the project implementation units,
mm-hmm,
that are attached to every ministry. So far now, we are seeing a very significant improvement.
Probably, what are the rates if we're looking at it from a percentage point of view?
Well, it depends, because some of the projects are long-term in nature,
right, mm-hmm,
and we keep looking at it year after year. But the ones that we now, for example, the ones that we are looking at from the previous year, mm-hmm, it's now over 80%.
Right.
Yeah.
Fantastic. There's also the issue of, when you talk about commodity pricing, Rwanda, just like most East African countries, we are import reliant as far as oil and gas or energy is concerned. How big an effect has this been, especially with the falling global crude prices?
Yeah, this is why I told you within the budget, we focused on developing our own industries.
Mm-hmm.
You see, the only way you can, first of all, understand that we are still far away in terms of developing our industries,
right,
is when you look at the composition of GDP. Agriculture is 33%. Our own service sector is 46%. But industry, mm-hmm, is now 15%.
Right.
And you could see the combination within the figure that were released this week on GDP numbers,
mm-hmm,
where our economy grew by 7.3%. You could see that with 15% in terms of the industry,
right,
then that one is very, very low, because meaning that you are producing agriculture, but then how do you process,
right,
anything that comes out of the agriculture? That shows that there is really a gap.
Right. So a lot of it is
that
sold
way
as
then
raw.
We are trying to address this.
Mm-hmm.
Initially, you would think that by providing incentives, it would be sufficient for the private sector to be able to react to the incentives and be able to increase the exports. But we've realized that actually we need to do something about it by establishing the special economic zone,
right,
the industrial parks, and the provincial parks, the district industrial parks, so that those areas, we provide the necessary infrastructure, the roads, the electricity,
mm-hmm,
the IT, the water, and all the other infrastructure that are
right
necessary.
Right.
And also in some of the areas, for some of the strategic products, let me say, for example, textiles, then you find that we also contribute to the advanced factory units, so that you don't come and start constructing. You should find something ready for you to go.
Right.
And that's why you've seen some of the companies like C&H have benefited from this. They started initially hiring 300 people, now 500 people. Now they are going to 900 and also to over 5,000.
Right.
Because we are also coming in terms of facilitating them.
Right.
By doing that, then you are really encouraging the companies,
mm-hmm,
which are producing things that we may have been importing anyway. But then by helping those companies, they produce for exports, but at the same time, they also produce for domestic consumption.
Right.
And by having specific areas, then we are very sure we are providing the right infrastructure.
Right.
And we can measure how much, whatever we do, the impact is going to have in terms of exports.
Right.
But at the same time, we have also provided resources through the Export Growth Fund. We call it Export Growth Fund, which is now in the Development Bank of Rwanda, that want to scale up actually, which is also helping in terms of addressing some of the issues that exporters also meet on a day-to-day basis.
Right.
Rather than going to the commercial banks and borrowing very expensive money, loans, then this time they have a window that's going to help them in terms of addressing some of the issues they face.
Has there been user education for the masses?
That's what we've been doing.
Okay.
I think every Rwandan now knows what EBM is.
Right.
Even if you may not know what E stands for,
You know what the machine
but
does.
At least you know what the machine is.
Right.
At least you know the punishment if you don't use it or if you use it wrongly. That now they know that.
Right.
But they need support continuously. And now that we are going to roll it over even to SMEs, there is even more education that is necessary.
Right.
So that these people are helped rather than saying, do it. Fend for yourself.
Right.
And that's why the services, the EBM is going to come together with the services.
Right.
To make sure that we, because the more they understand it and the more they use it, then the taxes, as she said, should have been in the School of Economics.
Right.
That the taxes will go up, and that way then we are reducing what we get from outside.
Interesting.
But then what we get from outside is also in terms of two things. Is in terms of loans, which we may need for things that we cannot really use our money for, especially for the heavy infrastructure. Then at the same time, we get the grants. And we want to make sure that the grants are reduced to the minimum.
Right.
Because this time we have to be, for us to become self-reliant, what it means is that we can finance our budget, not 100% from our budget, because I don't know of any country that finances the budget 100% from the taxes.
Mm-hmm.
No, but then it is saying, if I need extra, then I can borrow, but then ensure that my deficit is quite in check.
Right.
Because the budget deficit, our own, last year was 5.4%, and now it is 3.9%.
Right.
In rich countries, it never exceeds 3%. We always want to be in that range, meaning that actually, if what cannot be covered by my by the taxes at the national level, then we can be able to borrow, but then ensuring that the gap, the deficit is not too big.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's interesting because Kenya's deficit is starting at around 8%, so we have a lot of lessons to learn. Honorable Minister, give us your closing comments, and I'd like you to comment about financing integrated projects. There are projects that we are doing with Uganda, with Kenya, the Northern Corridor Integrated Projects, SGR, and the like. Give us a sense of where they sit in the whole fiscal planning of this year as you give us your closing comment.
Yeah. No, thank you very much. You touched a very important point because as the global economy, really, it keeps changing. We used to have the financial crisis that happened in 2008, 2009.
Right.
It really affected most of the countries, actually globally. And now we've seen the tightening of the regulations, especially by the central bank, making, and that has really affected the liquidity coming in. And that's why the United States came in with the quantitative easing, where it was purchasing the bonds, the treasury bonds.
Right.
And that helps in terms of injecting liquidity. But now that has stopped. That window has stopped. And the quantitative easing in, by the European Central Bank and the Bank of England and the likes, it hasn't been as much as what the United States used to pump in every month, $86 billion US dollars.
Right.
Was just too much. Now, that has stopped. That means that actually we are also being squeezed.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we are seeing the global economy being affected in different ways. And for countries like us, who don't have mature capital markets and they cannot compete and are being affected by the global commodity fluctuations, then we need to rely basically on, for a big part, on the regional integration, on the regional trade. And that's why the regional infrastructure, the easing of the movement of people and goods and services becomes very, very important. And that's why for us, Rwanda, with the help of our leaders, really, we are focused on how we make sure that we integrate from the Northern Corridor and also from the Central Corridor.
Right.
The Northern Corridor, you followed up the projects in energy, the projects in the railway that is linking us between us, Uganda, and Kenya, which is still going on, and many other projects that are really helping in terms of the putting the infrastructure in place.
Right.
But at the same time, removing all the necessary barriers the road blocks, the way bridges that are affecting the common customs union, which has been reduced and is helping our own country. Removing the travel restrictions,
right,
meaning you can use your ID, and also making sure the whole area is a one area network. That means there are no roaming charges. You can go there and still conduct your businesses. And now we are working on the payment system, which is going to ease in terms of payment much, much easier. We're also working with Tanzania on the railway and the Central Corridor Railway, and also discussing other projects in terms of infrastructure that can help our countries, especially in terms of trade.
Right.
So these projects are ongoing. The ones in the Northern Corridor, the meetings happen every 2 to 3 months.
Right.
And the next one will be in Kenya in next month. And we continue to monitor and see the progress, especially on the railway, mm-hmm, and also on the infrastructure.
Right.
Each of the countries you have established the infrastructure development levy that is specifically meant for facilitating the cross-border infrastructure.
Right.
And that way then you can leverage that one and bring in more resources. But I think this would help in terms of making sure that the region becomes the buffer in terms of trade and also in terms of bad times. But I think this is just one part. It doesn't stop us from also focusing on international trade,
right,
but with the backup of the region.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Yeah. Minister. We'd like to put a pause there. We've been taking a look at the Rwandan 2016-17 budget with the Honorable Minister of Finance and Economic Planning, Claver Gatete. And you've been watching the CNBC Africa Rwanda Focus debate on the Rwandan budget. In the audience, we've also had students from the University of Rwanda. My name is Bonney Tunya. Thank you for watching.